What's going on, guys? You're watching JayzTwoCents, and it's that time of the week again where we're going to bring you Tech Addiction. That show where I bring you some of the more uncommon news happening in the world of technology, and we've got a lot going on right now. We've got Computex, we've got E3 coming up, and we've got Comic-Con coming up next month. So Tech Addiction's about to get very hot and very heavy. This wouldn't be Tech Addiction if I didn't start stuff off with just a little bit of Apple news. If you're a tech addict like I am, just look behind me if you have no idea how addicted I am to technology. You may go to a lot of different forums, you may go to eBay, you may go someplace where you're gonna buy something online and you wanna send money. So what do? You use PayPal, or you use Google Payments, or you use some sort of an online trading website. So Apple's really interested in getting in on the whole online currency thing as well, and they realized nobody's filed a patent for any of this technology regarding sending and receiving money electronically. So what does Apple do? They go and file a patent on the technology that they have not developed themselves. PayPal is the first pioneer when it comes to online currency trading, followed by Google Payments. And of course, once Google gets involved, you know Apple's gonna do the same thing. And what do you get here? You now get Apple, which is the largest technology company in the world, and they're now on the radar for being the world's largest patent troll. It makes me really ashamed to even own an iPhone.
Oh my God.
I think it's wrong. I've said it in so many tech editions. We need a major overhaul of the United States patent system because it is allowing and empowering these trolls to do this sort of thing. And Apple, you are the world's biggest troll. Of course, with E3 happening right around the corner, we've got all sorts of game trailers being released. We've got new games being talked about. We've got consoles. We've got so much happening in the world of electronics, entertainment. And what would be E3 without talking about a little bit of Call of Duty? Or Modern Warfare? Or in this case, Gameloft's Modern Combat? Or Modern Combat 5? Gameloft is really known for just bringing you blatant ripoffs of other games, and Modern Combat for the iPhone or the iPad or iOS device is basically a play on Call of Duty. And in the past, it's been okay, but it's never been incredible. But however, Modern Combat 5 for iOS actually looks really, really good. If you've got an iPad or an iPhone, this may be something you want to consider picking up. Just watch this trailer. It looks really well put together. And it's amazing the amount of graphics technologies that we're getting on tablets and smartphones. And if you're not happy with the way that the future of gaming is going on consoles or PC, mobile platforms are definitely looking like they're going to be the future of gaming. I still don't think this game holds a candle compared to Call of Modern Battlefield Warfighter 9000 coming out next year by Tradice. God, that was hard to say. Call of Modern Battlefield Warfighter 9000. Another game trailer that's been released for E3 2013 is Wolfenstein: The New Order. One of the first shooter games that I ever played as a child was Castle Wolfenstein 3D. The graphics were horrible. I think there was like 14 pixels on the screen. You could only control which way you turned, right, left, straight, forward, or back, and you had to shoot and fight Hitler and other Nazis and some abominations that they made. It was a really fun game. But Wolfenstein: The New Order takes it all the way to the modern era, and it recreates what happens if Germany actually won World War II. Just check out the trailer.
So much has changed. I've been gone for too long. beat us to the bomb. No one knows how. The world was forced into submission. They took our freedom. Tore down what took centuries to build. They terrorized the world with their power. Enslaved millions. Uprisings. Rebellions. Resistance. Crushed beneath an iron boot. They're stealing our future. Flaunting their might. They think the war is over. But they're dead wrong.
I cannot wait to check out this game. This is definitely going to be a Jay's buy. So it's been exactly 1 week since I converted to the Intel 3770K, and I've been getting a lot of flack about why I went with an older platform. So I want to give you guys just a little bit of an update about how I feel about the system 1 week later. I do not regret my purchase whatsoever. I was able to recoup a lot of the cost from selling my AMD system. The performance jump while live streaming has been insane. You guys yourself have been watching my live streams over on Twitch, and you said right away that everything was smoother, there was less lag, there was less delay on when things happened versus when you saw them. Overall, the streaming experience has just been so much better. Rendering times improved a little bit, not by much. I would say maybe 15% better improvement times. Temperatures are good. And I've been able to overclock mine to 4.8 gigahertz stable. I backed it off to 4.7 just to bring the temperatures down just a little bit. So that's a 1.2 gigahertz overclock over the base clock on the 3770. Now, when it comes to reports on the 4770K on Haswell, things haven't been as consistent as they were with Ivy Bridge. The overclocking has been there's been a huge range of overclock success. Some people can only get 4.2, some people can go all the way to 5 gigs, some people are crashing at 4.0, temperatures are all over the place. In fact, one of the things I was really holding out for to find out with Haswell was whether or not they fixed the heat spread or thermal paste issues that they were having with Ivy Bridge. Apparently they didn't address them. Intel felt there was no reason to fix the thermal temperature issues. And they did not go back to the standard soldering procedures for the internal heat spreader. So I looked at it as overclocking instability, temperature control, and the internal GPU improvements, which I don't need and don't use, did not make sense for me to go Haswell for my desktop. Now, a lot of people said, yeah, but now you've limited your upgrade path because 1150 is the new socket, and because you're on an older motherboard now, you probably won't be able to upgrade and this and that. Well, guess what, people? The situation was the same when it came to Z77. If you wanted to get the most out of your Ivy Bridge processor, you had to go with a Z77 board. In most cases, Intel, when they bring out a new chip, they bring out a new architecture and a new platform that's going to require you to buy a new motherboard anyway. Whether it be because of a socket change or a chipset change, to get the most out of your system, you're going to buy a new motherboard. But you know what? I'm perfectly happy with my system. It's been a week. I have absolutely no regrets. And I'm just going to keep on trucking along. But AMD is not a bad processor. I do not talk bad about AMD whatsoever. I've owned AMD for 3 years. It's served me very, very well. But I'm just going back to my roots, which is that of Intel. And Intel meets all of my power user needs. And trust me when I say I'm using every single inch of power that this 3770K has. In fact, the only upgrade path I see me going in the future is that of Ivy Bridge E, if the Extreme Series turns out to be worth it. Yes, I understand I could have gone with a 2011 board, but it would have cost me as much on just a 2011 processor that I spent on this entire board and processor combo. So I'm happy with my choice. You may disagree with it. That's your prerogative. Build what you want. But in my computer, I am perfectly happy. So a lot of you guys have been asking about my opinion when it comes to Google Glass. I didn't know a whole lot about it. I haven't really been following much going on with Google. But I can tell you that I found an article that I found to be very, very ironic when it came to Google Glass. Google Glass is being banned in a lot of areas. It's being banned in gyms, it's being banned in movies, it's being banned in sensitive areas, courts, police stations. There's a lot of places where you're not allowed to bring your Google Glass. And if you're not aware of what Google Glass is, it's basically some glasses that you put on, and they've got a little camera in there, and it's designed to give you a really unique first-person view of your life. I mean, you could wear it and use it to vlog and use it as a point of view vlog. It's really kind of neat. The problem is it's considered a huge privacy risk. It's considered a huge invasion of privacy because people could be walking around recording you and you don't even know it. Now that kind of starts to trample upon a little bit of the privacy laws where once you're in public, you're free reign to be recorded. But what I find truly ironic about this story is that Google is very, very defensive over its Google Glass and the fact that it doesn't really violate privacy because of what I just said. However, Google executives have banned Google Glass in their own boardrooms. You're not allowed to bring Google Glass anywhere in the executive boardrooms, anywhere in the Google headquarters. Now, it just seems like a little bit of bittersweet irony. It may seem like Google has something to hide. The bottom line is, if you have Google Glass, I think it's kind of neat. Tell me what you think about it. I personally wouldn't use it. It kind of seems a little bit creepy to me, actually, just to walk around recording what it is your eye sees. But maybe you feel a little bit different. How do you guys feel about Google Glass? Put it down in the comments and let me know. Okay, guys, it's time for everyone's favorite part of the show, and that's Technology's Dumbass of the Week. So this week's Technology's Dumbass of the Week comes to you all the way from Great Britain. And our tech dumbass goes by the name of Lord Turnbull. Lord Turnbull is a British judge. He also believes that a 13-year-old boy who murdered his 14-year-old friend over a dispute on an online video game, probably Call of Duty, was fueled by his rage and his exposure to violent video games. And he flat out told this kid during court that he feels that his exposure to violent video games is what empowered him to live out his fantasy to murder somebody, and that violent video games are the direct root cause of the murder that this kid performed. Had nothing to do with the fact that he was 13 and drunk. It has to do with the fact that he was playing a violent video game. And because of that, kids now are going to start slashing necks everywhere. First Britain, next America, next North Korea, maybe. I don't think they're allowed to own video games. But bottom line is, Lord Turnbull of Great Britain, you are technology's highest dumbass of the week. Alright guys, that's it for this week. Next week's going to be really exciting. We've got a lot going on over at E3. Computex is going to bring us a lot of stuff this week, and I'll be kind of summing some of it up on some tweets, maybe some videos. I'm kind of waiting for all the information to come in from China. I understand that the show is just kind of wrapping up, so there's some things people have been asking me regarding some of the new graphics cards that are coming out and some of the new stuff happening with Haswell. We're going to get all on that, I promise, and because I now own an Intel, I'm going to bring you guys the much-awaited, promised Intel overclocking guide since I've got mine stable at 4.8. We're going to see what we can do, and I'm going to empower you guys to overclock your processors, and I'm going to see you guys next week on Tech Addiction because I'm getting very tired of hitting my microphone and doing this with my arms and being very annoying because this is just how we do it. Ow!